Welcome to Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore. Our goal is to bring evidence and experience to illuminate critical public health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, for our 500th episode, an update on the global emergency of monkeypox. Dr. Josh Sharfstein speaks to Dr. Chris Beyrer, the Desmond Tutu Professor of Health and Human Rights at Johns Hopkins and the incoming director of Duke Global Health Institute. This episode is a little bit longer than our usual interviews, but we think you will agree it's worth it. Let's listen.
Chris Beyrer, thank you so much for joining me on Public Health On Call to talk about monkeypox. You have been involved in advising the response, is that right?
Yes, I'm on the WHO committee, the Scientific and Technical Advisory Committee on HIV, viral hepatitis, and sexually transmitted infections. So in that role, of course, we are dealing with monkeypox now as a new emergence with changing epidemiology and more evidence of sexual spread.
So what is the global picture right now?
Well, it's really striking. This particular emergence appears to have begun in West Africa about 5 years ago. So 2017 is when there was evidence of this West African clade of monkeypox spreading in Nigerian populations, and with a differing epidemiology, not with what we've seen in Central Africa, where it's been endemic for many years and where many of the cases are in people with exposure to wild animals, particularly wild rodents, but where there have been more deaths and more pediatric cases, and most of the monkeypox deaths there have been in children under five. But in Nigeria, for the last 5 years, this virus has been spreading with more focal lesions, with more evidence of what looks like sexual exposure, even specifically looking more like general ulcer disease. And unfortunately, this is another example of the world ignoring this for 5 years. No effort to vaccinate around those cases to try and use the tools that we have to contain that outbreak. And then In an emergence event that is still not clear, in May or perhaps earlier this past spring, there were two large parties, rave parties, gatherings of gay men, one in the Canary Islands, a pride event. Canary Islands are off the coast of Spain, and then one in Antwerp, Belgium. And both of those are big European gatherings where men from across Europe and other countries and continents internationally gather, and both had outbreaks of monkeypox. And since then, there has been very rapid spread. We now are at about 19,000 cases confirmed globally. And it's very interesting. It's in more than 76 countries. And only six of them are countries that have endemic monkeypox. So 70 countries are reporting cases of new spread in places where this is not an endemic virus. And that's 98% of the cases.
And now it's been declared by WHO.
That's right. There was an earlier meeting to look at this emergence when it was in about 30 countries and we were at several thousand cases. WHO at that time decided it did not meet the criteria. Many of us thought that was a poor decision because of how quickly this particular outbreak is spreading and in how many countries. We just met again last week. It was a very divided meeting. The committee could not come, the advisory committee to WHO could not come to a consensus on whether to declare this. The vote was pretty evenly divided. But this is an example of Tedros, the WHO director general, really showing leadership. And he just overruled the committee and decided that this had met the criteria for a global health emergency of international concern. And that's really important.
So what changes? What is the strategy globally for trying to get this back under control?
Well, you know, WHO has a coordinating function, so one hopes that WHO's own resources will now be focused more on this public health emergency. It also gives the member states more ability and more encouragement to act. Probably the most important thing is that in this particular disease emergence, very different from COVID and radically different from HIV, we actually have vaccines that we know work already. Most of them stockpiled, but nevertheless, that can be ramped up and the distribution of those can be ramped up. There's been a lot of criticism that we've been too slow to do that, particularly in the US, where, for example, when New York City Pride was getting going, the city had a testing capacity of about 20 cases a day and had very limited vaccine supplies. That has allowed New York to become an epicenter of this outbreak. It's about 25% of all the cases in the US, altogether about 900 cases, and of the total, 3,500.
So one of the questions that's always come up with COVID is, you know, will it become endemic? The answer to that is a resounding yes.
Yeah.
You know, COVID is not going away. It has all these reservoirs. The goal for monkeypox, at least in theory, is to get rid of it, you know, if possible. Do you think that that's possible? And then if so, what are the strategies that could be successful?
Yes. Yeah. So we do, I think, have the tools to contain this outbreak. It's not going well. So we were happy that the WHO made that decision. This US CDC still has not. One of the challenges is that what you would like to see ideally is very good contact tracing, identification of contacts of people who've been exposed or who are in sexual networks or social networks with monkeypox cases. But in Europe, particularly in the UK, but also in Spain and a number of other countries, what is turning up is a number of cases that don't appear to be epidemiologically linked. That means there's more community transmission going on than we think. And that also has turned out to be the case in the US. With smallpox, which is, of course, a related virus, it's pretty closely related, although smallpox is much more lethal than monkeypox, thankfully. With smallpox, the eventual tool that really controlled that epidemic and eradicated that disease was ring vaccination, vaccinating all the contacts and communities around known cases. There is some thinking that that probably is going to be important. Right now, we're using the vaccines that we have. There's a two-dose JYNNEOS vaccine that is safe and effective, including in people with immunocompromise. That's very important because the smallpox vaccine is a live vaccinia vaccine that is not safe for people with immunocompromise and not safe for people with HIV. So when you have an epidemic that is primarily spreading in gay and bisexual men, you have to think about how many of those people have HIV. And it's about 15% of all gay men worldwide are living with the HIV virus. Now, we can't really use the existing smallpox vaccine for that population, but we can use the JYNNEOS vaccine. It's manufactured in Denmark. The U.S. actually owns a significant amount of that vaccine, and we've been slow to get it into the United States and start using it. But with vaccines, with contact tracing, with good epidemiology, we could contain this. But right now, as we have seen with other outbreaks, the response is much slower than the virus. The virus is ahead of us right now.
Yeah. I want to ask you a bit about stigma, because one connection that's been drawn to the emergence of HIV is the fact that, you know, the initial cases are predominantly in population of men who have sex with men, and some people don't want to, you know, be known that they're doing that. And there have been already discussions about the challenges in focusing a response, particularly in the gay community at a time when there still is stigma, maybe not quite like at the emergence of HIV. How do you see this as a potential obstacle to the control of monkeypox?
Yeah. It's a very important question. First of all, a couple of things to say. This is yet another virus that has emerged from essentially the Central African rainforest, really the same area as HIV, in fact. It has a horrible stigmatizing name. It's hard to think of a worse name than monkeypox. It's not actually a monkey virus. The reason it's called monkeypox is one of the first major outbreaks was identified in a monkey facility where the animals got infected from rodents. It's really a rodent virus, although rodent pox wouldn't be much less stigmatizing. It also is overwhelmingly right now spreading in networks of men who have sex with men. And nobody should sugarcoat that. That is the reality. That is where it is spreading now. It is unlikely that it will stay there. And if you think, for example, about the emergence that we saw of MRSA, methicillin-resistant Staph aureus, it started in networks of men who have sex with men. It very quickly became, because it's like monkeypox, a disease of close contact, doesn't have to be sexual contact, skin to skin contact. Then we had outbreaks in athletes. Then we had outbreaks in prisons and jails. It became endemic in prisons and jails because of the hygiene issues and the skin to skin contacts. So this does have the potential for a wider spillover. But nevertheless, right now, the focus has to be on men who have sex with men, gay and bisexual men. I will say that the White House, where I've been on a number of calls with the LGBTQ community and advocacy groups, the White House has convened these very quickly with their Office of LGBTQ Outreach, is worried, is thinking about this stigma issues and how to address it. Also the CDC, been on a number of calls with the CDC around these issues. And what the administration, CDC, the White House, WHO are trying to do is really strike the balance between being realistic about this outbreak and where it's spreading and not stigmatizing, right? And that is not easy to do. Now, of course, when you get down to the local level, the questions really are going to be particularly important, for example, state and city health departments, because many of them are going to be the places where people will go and will seek testing and will seek, which is quite limited still, and vaccination. And so it's at that local level where we're also more concerned. So far, many people have been reporting, this is all anecdotal, that it hasn't been a terribly stigmatizing experience. But there have been people who have had clear risks for monkeypox, gay men in particular, who've been honest about their exposure, traveled to Europe, who found it very hard to get tested. And the testing is onerous. People don't want to get tested because there's a screening test for this family of viruses, the orthopox viruses, and then there's a confirmatory test. And until very recently, only the CDC could do that confirmatory test. So for a provider, it was a two-step onerous process with a lot of paperwork, and that hindered our testing, certainly.
Hopefully that is getting better now with some of the changes that they're making.
Yep.
There is also the local issue of what to advise people, you know, and we've seen in New York some debates hit the front pages over within health departments. You know, do you tell people, you know, to stop going to certain kinds of parties, or do you just tell them to take extra precautions? How do you see that discussion playing out?
Yeah. Well, of course, this for many gay men is such an echo of what was happening with the early spread of HIV. Right. Where there was safe sex messaging, you know, people need to use condoms, maybe you consider reducing the number of partners, and eventually the very contentious battle over closing, for example, bathhouses in New York City. So that is playing out again. There is, for example, a recommendation from the CDC about how to participate in raves and group activities that may involve close bodily contact. The bad news here is that condoms do not protect against monkeypox because it's a skin-to-skin contact. It's not just general, orogenital or anogenital contact, so you don't have the same condom messaging. But it is really important for people to consider their own risk-taking, and many, you see this on blogs and conversations and on social media, that gay men are saying now is not the time for this kind of partying, particularly while vaccines are in such short supply.
Now, with COVID, for a long time, we said we need more tests. Then we got a lot of tests.
Yeah.
And then we said we need vaccines, and we got a lot of vaccines. But the United States still had 1 million people die of COVID. We still have a huge COVID problem. And a lot of that has to do with the weakness of our system to deliver tests, to do contact tracing, and to provide vaccines. That system hasn't really changed very much. There have been a lot of calls for strengthening public health in this country. But do you see as a weakness in the monkeypox response, even as the amount of tests and vaccines go up, that we may fail to deliver them?
There's no question that that is a real challenge. And I would say, Josh, that that is a particular concern if we get out of the networks where the virus is spreading now. Our best opportunity for achieving control and ending this outbreak is while it is so concentrated in gay men, gay and bisexual men. And I say that because the LGBTQ community has a long record because of HIV and because of COVID of doing better in terms of, for example, public health messaging. There's a lot of resilience in the community. There's a lot of public health experience. And vaccine rates are much higher. So, you know, these last 2 weeks, for example, New York City has been out in the gay communities on Fire Island in New York City with bringing the monkeypox vaccines to the community. And the lines are around the block and they've been running out of vaccine. They haven't had enough to meet demand. So if we can contain this before we get wider spread, this is our best shot. We don't have, and we have not seen the same kinds of vaccine hesitancy, for example, in the LGBT community that you see in a number of other communities. So I think that resilience and the fact that certainly for gay men of my generation, this is our third pandemic, right? We are a community that is very seasoned and has a lot of ability to take care of our own. And there are many people in the LGBT community who have public health and medical expertise. In that sense, we are quite less marginalized than many other communities.
That is a very interesting perspective. And I really do hope that it plays out that way, that we can get the supplies that we need, a vaccine and tests, that we can deploy them, particularly while the disease is relatively contained, and you know, really put an end to a lot of the transmission we're seeing. Dr. Beyrer, it's great to have you on the podcast. I know you will be leaving Johns Hopkins shortly and going to the Duke Global Health Institute, which you will be leading. But we really do hope that you will keep in touch with us frequently.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, Hopkins has been my home for 30 years and wonderful colleagues like yourself and so many others. Still have doctoral students that I have to see through to the end of their training. And I look forward also to the ways that research universities like Hopkins and Duke can work together and can work together on these kinds of emergence. I will just say as a last comment that one of the things that this monkeypox emergence really tells us is that the epidemiology of this virus has changed. And we don't understand that. We don't really know why and how that happened. And we need to know to really be able to get control. So there is a lot of science and a lot of epidemiology to be done here. And that's the role that great research universities can really play, like Hopkins, like Duke.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Public Health on Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by J.B. Arbogast, Holly Cardinal, Spencer Greer, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media run by Grace Holes Fernandez and Amber Bryan Singletary. Thank you for listening.